Good morning, everyone, and welcome to another edition of On the Mark TV and Radio here on Westfield Community Programming, Channel 15 and 89.5 FM WSKB. I'm your host, Mark Auerbach, and today we're going to be talking with our first guest is Tina Gorman from the Westfield Senior Center. You hear or see Tina every Wednesday morning from 6 to 8, so she was here this morning. She went home, took a quick nap, changed outfits.
I wish.
Changed outfits. And here she is back at show. Tina, it's good to see you.
Thank you. It's good to be here. It's great. It's nice to be here on in the other role, not the interviewer, but the interviewee.
Yeah. I mean, I get to do that every once in a while. It's really a treat.
It's fun.
One of the things that we're talking about later on in this program, I've got this gentleman coming on to talk about robotic pets that have been designed to help as companions for people with dementia and Alzheimer's and other diseases. And you work with people all day long in your role that are living with dementia or Alzheimer's or their caregivers and things like that. And people ask me constantly, because I was a caregiver to my father, where do you go for resources? What's available out there? And I think that there are people that are caregivers right now that don't know where to turn for resources. I mean, they go to their, they take their patient, their parent,
their loved one,
loved one to the doctor, and the doctor says do A, B, C, D, and E, and then it's left to them to figure out what to do. So supposing you have a parent or a loved one that's got dementia or Alzheimer's or any other illness that comes along with being a senior, where do you start?
Oh, my goodness. It is, you know, there's the Alzheimer's Association does a training every year, a big conference, and it's called A Map Through the Maze. And I think that title is really fitting because that's what it's like. It's like a maze. And I think, let's start with a few of the basics. So first of all, when we use the word, you know, a lot of people are familiar with Alzheimer's disease. A lot of people are familiar with dementia. I'm not sure if they understand how the two relate to each other. So dementia is kind of the big umbrella. And under that umbrella of dementia, which is, you know, can include a whole host of symptoms with, you know, memory loss, short-term memory loss, long-term memory loss, spatial issues, depth perception issues. There are a whole lot of things that can go along with dementia. Underneath that big umbrella, Alzheimer's is one type of dementia. And then there are a lot of dementias that are related to, there's a dementia that's related to having a series of strokes, many strokes, multi-infarct dementia. There's a, you know, there's Lewy body dementia. They're all different kinds. So it's really hard, A, to lump everything under, because when you say dementia, we are talking about a wide array, you know, a wide array of symptoms. It also depends on, because dementia tends to be progressive, so it depends on where someone is in what I call their journey of dementia or Alzheimer's disease. Alzheimer's disease tends to be it can be a little bit more scripted, so we have sort of a sense of, okay, if this is where we are now, this is probably going to be where we're heading in the next phase. The problem with Alzheimer's and a lot of the other dementias is you kind of sometimes don't know how quickly things are going to progress. Typically, with Alzheimer's disease, if someone is diagnosed later in life, it tends to be a slower progression. So you'll see a decline, but it tends to be more gradual. If the person is younger and it's an earlier onset Alzheimer's, it tends to be a more rapid decline. So that's important for caregivers to know. And I just had this conversation with one of my coworkers in between my radio show and this show. And we were talking about the fact that having some type of a map, having some type of an idea in your head, if not the timing of things, but at least what can I expect, you know, coming down the road, I think helps with planning. So in terms of resources, I would say certainly for Alzheimer's disease, our major resource is the Alzheimer's Association. Now, that's a national organization with local chapters. So our local chapter here in Western Massachusetts is located in Springfield. they are wonderful at, you know, providing educational resources. That's usually my first, I'll refer people to them first off and say, if you're looking for a support group, if you're looking for where do I get, you know, a hospital bed. I mean, there are just so many different things that if I'm looking for, what are some ideas of what can I do with my loved one? Or my husband is now wandering. He's getting out in the middle of the night and it's cold and, you know, I'm worried about him. How do I prevent that? How do I stop that? Or how do we, you know, what do we do about that? So I think legal issues, I mean, they hold trainings. They will provide informational resources. And they do that for individuals, for families, for the local councils on aging. So we get a lot of information from them. So we typically really support and a lot of their fundraisers because we, you know, we get so much information from them. So definitely, and you can also go online for a lot of this information as well. You always have to be careful when you're going online, of course, as you know, Mark. You want to go to a reputable resource. So the Alzheimer's Association, you know, National Institute of Health, they've got some really good information on, you know, on dementia and working with folks with dementia. Certainly you can call your local senior center and we, you know, because depending on what people are looking for, if someone calls us and says, well, you know, my mom has dementia or my mom has Alzheimer's disease, we're at a point where we're going to need some home services. You know, I have an outreach coordinator that will work with someone with that on the local level. If they're looking for resources and information or legal information or things like that, we may steer them to the local Alzheimer's Association. But I also always tell people, if they call us for help and we refer them to some other organization or some other agency, that doesn't mean we're done with you, okay? Because if they now need help with something else, same issue, but you know now we've got other things going on, call us back. You know, then we'll take the next step and maybe we can help or maybe we'll refer you to a different agency. So,
yeah, I mean, that's part of it. The other thing is, as a caregiver, where do you go for help? I mean, I found that in helping take care of my dad, and I talked to my colleagues and my friends who are all in the same age level, the taking care of parents, that it becomes overwhelming. You can go online and find stuff, but you can also find more misinformation online than good information.
Yep. Again, I am a firm believer personally in support groups. We run a couple of different support groups at the Senior Center. I do not run an Alzheimer's or dementia support group because Beth Cardillo, who is the executive director of Armbrook Village here in Westfield, and Armbrook is a senior living residence. They do have a dementia unit, a memory impaired unit. And Beth is kind of in our area, sort of the guru of all things dementia. So Beth runs a support group. And because of COVID, she's been doing it virtually. And it's been really fascinating because she said, you know, prior to COVID, of course, they were doing it. People would come. It's once a month. They meet once a month, the last Wednesday of the month. You do call. And they usually, when they were doing it in person, would, you know, provide a meal and snacks and so forth. Doing it virtually, Beth said the advantage of that is she said, I have family members of people that are living at Armbrook who are, you know, out in California, and they can participate. I'm going to sneeze. Oh, it passed. So anyway, I would certainly steer people to that support group because that's just a wealth of information. You put a bunch of people together who are in that same caregiving boat, and, you know, I don't have all the answers. Beth doesn't have all the answers, but you've got a situation going on with your dad, your mom, your brother, whatever, and somebody else. I guarantee you, if you get a 15 or 20 people in the room are going to say, you know what, I dealt with that with my husband last year, and here's what worked for us. I think it's important to understand right out of the gate, Mark, there is no cookie cutter recipe for this. I wish that there were.
It would make it so much easier for everybody if there were.
It would. But you know what? Part of the issue is that you are dealing with individuals, and everyone is different going into it. So if someone gets a diagnosis of dementia or Alzheimer's, that was on top of whatever their personality was before that. And I'll give you an example. My father had Alzheimer's, and that's not news. I've shared that on my show and as I've done trainings. My father was a chemical engineer, very black and white. He was a scientist, you know, very black and white, kind of, you know, routine driven, pretty rigid. My brother's mother-in-law had Alzheimer's at the same time that my dad did. Much more kind of her personality, much more happy-go-lucky, you know, kind of would laugh things off. The way that they kind of journeyed through their dementia was like night and day. You know, my father would become frustrated. He would become, you know, loud. He would get angry at himself and angry. He would kind of lash out, not physically, but verbally with, you know, things weren't going right. My brother's mother-in-law, you know, Mama Ruth, would just kind of be, you know, oh, I can't believe I can't remember that. You know, she would just kind of, it was a much lighter, more fun environment. And it was much more stressful around my dad. We had to learn how to work around those things. So because you're dealing with individuals that were different going into it, and then because people are at different places in their dementia, you know, maybe in the earlier stages, and there are a lot of differences as, you know, they progress through this. And then the other thing to keep in mind, to make it even more complicated, is a lot of people have what we call comorbidities. So they may also be dealing with diabetes, heart problems, COPD, you know, breathing issues. I mean, there are all kinds of other things on top of the Alzheimer's. So how families interact and react is, it's going to be different. And that's what makes it so challenging. But I also think that's why support groups can really be a blessing, because you've got a big enough group of people that somebody in there is going to be able to say, you know what, I had a similar situation, and this is what seemed to work for us. At least it gives the family something to try. Then you can come back and say, well, that didn't work so well. Or, but you know what? We were able to tweak that a little bit. And we found if we did it this way, it worked. And then that might help the next person sitting on the other side of the table down the road.
Yeah. I mean, a lot of it is sharing what works for an individual, sharing it with somebody else. One of the things that I've noticed in research and everything else is that dementia and Alzheimer's, it used to be considered senility and old age, mm-hmm. but it's impacting people that are much younger now.
Yeah, and it is.
Early onset, there are people in their 40s and 50s and possibly younger.
Yeah. And typically we see, like, especially with early onset Alzheimer's, there are some genetic links with that. So sometimes you'll actually see that in families, which is scary, obviously, to the family members. You know, when I've been in this field for a very long time, and it's been so long that when I first started Alzheimer's, I can remember the first nursing home I worked in, and that was back in the 70s, late 70s, early 80s. I think I had like one or two people that actually were diagnosed with Alzheimer's, but at that time I called it like the trash can, you know, diagnosis, which was organic brain syndrome, OBS. It meant nothing. It just meant this person is confused. It gave you, there was really no organic reason for it. Nobody really knew why. And it didn't really tell you anything about what does that mean. You know, as I said, Alzheimer's, there are some patterns that people follow. But with a diagnosis of OBS, and they don't use that anymore. And as you said, you know, you'd see early onset senility or, you know, different words like that. We don't really use those anymore, for one thing, because it doesn't, it's like saying, you know, if somebody had a nervous breakdown, well, that's not really a medical diagnosis.
It's kind of a catch-all.
Exactly. Yeah. Could be a whole lot of things. So, yeah, you're right.
So, when people come in, if somebody comes in that has early onset, mm-hmm. Is there a different, you said earlier at the beginning that generally the course of the disease is more rapid mm-hmm. than it is if they come in at an older age.
Yep.
So are there different strategies to help families when somebody comes in and it's a person who's in their 40s or their early 50s?
Yeah, I think, you know, when I've worked with someone with early onset, well, first of all, you know, when I work with anyone who actually has a diagnosis of Alzheimer's, and a lot of people don't have that diagnosis because they haven't gone through the neuropsychological testing, it's the physician's best guess based on what they're seeing. But if I have someone who has a known diagnosis, one of the first things that I do is I particularly like there's a kind of a scale that is and I wish I had thought to bring it with me, but I did not. It talks about sort of the phases of Alzheimer's, and it breaks it down, I think, into 14 phases, sort of like six or seven major ones and then some subcategories. I find this is particularly helpful with someone with early onset because the decline tends to be more rapid. So you don't have the luxury if someone is, you know, just at the earlier stages, name finding, phrase, they can't, you know, they come up, can't come up with the phrases, keeps misplacing things, can't remember why I walked into a room, some of those kinds of things. That may be very short-lived, and we, you know, it may very quickly progress into something that's more, you know, can't do the checkbook anymore. I've really messed up the checkbook, which has repercussions. So I like this, these phases, because although it can be difficult for families, I mean, you know, a lot of us, you don't want to know what's coming down the pike or around the corner, but it really does help with planning, particularly with things like legal issues. That can become a real problem for families. If you don't plan ahead legally and it's somebody, say, with early onset and, you know, the house is in that person's name and, you know, you started to get into all kinds of things when that person can no longer make the decisions or maybe can no longer even remember how to write their name or, you know, things like that. So those are all things that so that's usually my starting place. And I usually say to people, I'm going to give you this. You may not be ready to see this right now, today, but I want you to hang on to it because, you know, hopefully within the next few weeks, you'll feel like you can at least start to look this over and see where, you know, what direction you're heading in. The other thing about early onset is that generally you're not dealing with a lot of comorbidities. A lot of times older people with Alzheimer's, they don't die of Alzheimer's disease. They die of some other, you know, heart thing or stroke, or, you know, whatever it is. But when people are younger and there aren't a lot of comorbidities, then it's generally the progression of the Alzheimer's. So, you know, again, you can kind of really see where things tend to go.
I know that there are primary care doctors, and then there are some primary care doctors that specialize in patients with dementia or Alzheimer's or seniors and things like
gerontology,
that.
Gerontology, yeah.
How do you find a good physician? Is through word of mouth? Where would you, if somebody came to you and said, my father was just diagnosed with dementia, and where do we go next?
Well, you know, that's interesting. I think even before you get to my father was just diagnosed, the questions that we tend to have most is where can people go for testing? You know, because generally wherever they go for testing, if the outcome is that, yes, you know, we're seeing clearly that this person has Alzheimer's or some other type of dementia, that person who has done the testing, you know, that medical provider that's done the testing can then steer the person to here are some resources for you in terms of medical providers. The bigger question that we get is, where do I go for the testing? And I have to be honest and say, you know, most recently we had a case. We had the person tested. We were really questioning the results of that test. I called Beth Cardillo, and Beth said, okay, here's where, you know, we would recommend. So she'll give, you know, she can give a couple of different, two or three in the area. And so, again, she's, you know, she's just a great resource.
Are there programs and services, for example, through the senior center, that adult daycare, so that if you are a caregiver and you need respite for a couple of hours, or you're a caregiver who works full time and needs somebody to kind of babysit somebody, are resources like that available through the senior center?
Well, there are resources available, Mark. We don't have an adult day health center at the Westfield Senior Center, and I don't think any of the Western Mass senior centers have them. Some of the ones on the east in the Boston area do. However, again, I go back to where are people in their stages of this? So if someone is at the point where they really need supervision, you know, all the time, and especially if you have a caregiver that works, we don't have it through the senior center. We have a wonderful adult day health center here in Westfield. It's Mercy Adult Day Health, and it's located on Clifton Street or Clifton Ave, right where Lukrensky's bus is. So it's right behind where Starbucks is on Route 20. And they have a fabulous program. And that is a program where, you know, I know they provide some transportation. I don't know if they provide it for everyone, but certainly the person can be dropped off. It doesn't have to be 5 days a week. I've had a lot of seniors that have used that, spouses that have used that, to just say, I need 2 days a week to go do my grocery shopping, get my hair done, maybe play cards with my friends, you know, something that's just a little escape for me. I personally think that adult day health is one of the most important and probably least known services that's out there. And the fact that we have an adult day health right here in Westfield is really important. Having said that, and of course we don't do, you know, the senior center does not do supervision, but what I have found is if we have someone who's been attending programs at the senior center for a number of years and they develop Alzheimer's or some other type of dementia, because I've seen this happen on many occasions, the senior center is a place that is already familiar to them. Their friends are already familiar. The friends have watched this progression, so they're aware of what's happening. And what I have found is generally they kind of take care of that person. So, I mean, unless it gets to a point where the person just requires more than that. But oftentimes that can go on for months or even a couple of years. I had one woman that, you know, clearly had dementia. She had volunteered in the old senior center for years, came to the new senior center, and every once a week her daughter would drop her off for bingo. Bingo was really, you know, in her brain. She wasn't going to forget how to play. She always sat with her friend, you know, her same kind of circle of friends, and they would kind of take care of her, make sure she had everything she needed for that couple hours. It was perfect. It was a perfect time for the family to be able to go do some things and know she's fine. Because if there was a problem, one of the friends is going to come and get a staff member. And, you know, and we're right there. And we had a history with that person. And that happens a lot more than you think. So sometimes some of those activities and programs, whether it's a fitness class, whether it's bingo, whether it's playing cards upstairs with the guys, I've seen the seniors kind of take care of each other. They're aware of the situation. And unless it becomes problematic, that can go on for quite a while.
Tina, we're out of time, but I want to thank you for staying late at the studio today.
Oh my gosh, you're so welcome.
Chat with us. So you can catch Tina Gorman every Wednesday morning from 6 a.m. to 8 a.m. on, I think it's Wake Up Wednesday.
Wake Up Wednesday. Wake Pete up and I Wednesdays. Are waking up.
Yeah, and here on Westfield Community Programming, Channel 15 and 89.5 FM WSKB, Tina Gorman. We're going to take a break to acknowledge the underwriters that have underwrite the programs that Tina and I do here, and we'll be back with more of On the Mark. Peter Coles is our chief engineer. If you want to watch this again, or you've missed part of it, or you want to share this edition with friends, it's archived on YouTube at WSKB Community Radio's YouTube page. We'll be right back.
Thank you.
Underwriting for the community programming of WSKB is provided by the Boys and Girls Club of Greater Westfield, serving the youth of the Whip City and surrounding communities since 1969. For more information on the Great Futures Club for ages 3 to 5, happening weekdays, and the Club Teen Center for ages 11 and older, weekdays from 6:30 till 8 p.m., go online at bcgwestfield.org or visit the club at 28 West Silver Street. The Boys and Girls Club of Greater Westfield. Great futures start here. Underwriting support for the community programming of WSKB is provided by the Greater Westfield Chamber of Commerce, the voice of business for the Greater Westfield communities. Informing, educating, advocating, the Chamber provides opportunities for members to make meaningful connections on local, regional, and state levels. For more information on the Chamber's many events, workshops, and programs, as well as the benefits of membership, visit westfieldbiz.org. The Chamber focuses on the most important economy, yours.
Hi, it's Bob Plass, and I have Wow It's Tuesday every Tuesday, 6 to 8. Wow It's Tuesday.
Community Radio,
89.5 WSKB.
I did it!
Live from Studio 120 at Westfield Technical Academy, this is WCPC Channel 15 and 89.5 FM WSKB Westfield.
Welcome back to On the Mark, everyone. I'm your host, Mark Auerbach. Peter Coles is our chief engineer. And when Tina Gorman left the studio after this last segment, she asked me to remind people that Westfield Community Programming Channel 15 has a lot of programming that comes from the Westfield Council on Aging. So those of you that are looking for resources can go to the Westfield Council on Aging or check Channel 15's programming. Our next guest is Steve Cohn, who's from coming into us today from Washington, D.C. He's the communications, marketing, and philanthropy guru for Capital Caring in Washington. He's a high school classmate of mine from Northfield Mount Hermon, who formerly was involved in marketing with American Express and AARP. And over the holidays, Steve sent me this email and said, you might want to watch this video. I'm working on a program to provide robotic pets as companions to people that are suffering from dementia and Alzheimer's and this and that. And I watched this half an hour video that Steve put together, and I said, wow, we really need to talk about this. This is a phenomenal program. I don't know, Steve, whether you actually invented the robotic pets or you're the guy that's marketing them and getting them out there to people, but what an incredible concept. So welcome to On the Mark.
Thanks, Mark. Actually, Hasbro created these pets back in 2015, thinking that they would be for moms to buy for their daughters or sons. And what they found was they were buying them for their mothers. So Hasbro spun off the robotic pet group in a year later in 2016 to focus specifically on making these pets available for dementia sufferers. There's been a lot of clinical data and studies done that prove what we see at Capital Caring with our patients who have dementia, that these pets do amazing things for them. And by the way, they're very lifelike. They respond to sight, sound, and touch, just like regular pets, live pets. And they were created also to be affordable. So robotics can be very expensive, but these pets are basically $150 each. You flip one switch and they will be acting much like a live pet. Batteries last about 3 to 4 months at a time.
And so the program that you're doing is to try to get the funding together, I would assume, to get these pets into the hands of people that need them. But if you're not in the Washington, D.C. area and you wanted to get one, are they available online or through retail? Or how do you make sure you're getting the right one that's not a toy?
Right. So actually, the best thing to do is to come to our landing page, which I'll explain in a second, Mark, which is Capital Caring, C-A-P-I-T-A-L, caring.org/companion pets. And what people will see there is, first of all, there are two variations of the dogs and three of the cats. So dogs come in two different color combos, cats come in three, and they can order any number of those from us, which will be shipped directly to them. And by the way, if they order through us, it's a tax deduction, which isn't the case if they were just going to order it, say, on Amazon. So they get a tax deduction if they order from Capital Caring. And if they wish, they can also make a donation so that we can provide these pets free of charge to dementia sufferers. As well as terminally ill children, which is another group that we're focused on to make these pets available.
Can you backtrack a little bit and tell us what Capital Caring is?
Right. So we were actually the first organization to open that provides hospice services in the nation in 1977. We were the very first one. And today there are 4,300 hospice organizations across the country. But we also are not-for-profit, which is a small minority of those total hospice groups. And by the way, we have a network of 80 not-for-profit hospice advanced illness care groups, because we care for two types of people, terminally ill, but also not terminally ill, just chronically ill and often home-limited or homebound. That's true of all of us. And all of us who are not-for-profits, Mark, have the same mission, which is we turn no one away, regardless of race, citizenship status. They don't have to be an American citizen or ability to pay. So it, everything we provide in our sister organizations is free. There's a very good one in our network up your way, which is called Care Dimensions. They're headquartered in Danvers. So that's a quick, history of us. So, and what we do.
And I got to ask you, how you got into the nonprofit and philanthropy sector. I mean, your career has been primarily in marketing. You've written some bestsellers in marketing. You worked with global companies like American Express. But we've also, as classmates going to an independent school, worked together to raise money over the years for our high school. How did you get into the idea of philanthropy and decide at this point in your career to do it full time?
Yeah, thanks for asking that question, Mark. Really the answer is I was very fortunate to be in Wall Street during a very, prosperous time for folks like me. And I decided a little over 10 years ago that I really wanted to give back to society. And that kind of came to me with someone, a recruiter friend of mine, who said, there's a big job at AARP. Would you be interested in talking to them? And I said, yeah, it's time for me to do something in the not-for-profit world. So I got the job running all of the business operations of AARP, membership and so forth, partnerships, and moved down to Washington to do that in 2010. I did that for 6 years. And then I worked for the American Bar Association as their chief revenue officer for 2 years. But, you can only spend a limited amount of time with thousands of lawyers. And then a very good friend of mine who runs Capital Caring asked me a little over 2 years ago if I would have any interest in helping him and the organization, really expand the brand, so to speak, get more knowledge out there in the communities we serve about what we do, which helps so many people at the end of life and their loved ones, or people who are just terminally ill. Because like our other sister organizations, 95% of the time we care for people where they reside, in their home or another facility. Which a lot of people don't understand about hospitals.
A lot of people don't understand the whole nonprofit world, and you come from the for-profit world. Nonprofits are just as fiscally responsible and have the same missions and goals as a for-profit company, but I guess it's just the legal structure in which they're set up. But how do you market philanthropy? I mean, you're doing a project like this. Are you taking traditional and non-traditional marketing skills to get this program up and running? Or does the fact that it's a philanthropic mission on both sides make it a different animal?
Well, two things, Mark. First, obviously, in our case, not-for-profit means that no one ever gets a bill. So there's no, oh my God, medical bills. We don't give a bill to anybody. Regardless, hospice care can run 6 months or longer. Chronic illness care can run years. So it's either covered by insurance or partly covered by insurance. Or if a person's uninsured or underinsured, we pick up the tab, thanks to philanthropy. Now, with regard to the pets, what I call my companion robotic pet pals, so Americans, not a big surprise, as a society, we don't like to think about dying. And so really the only people that contribute to hospice organizations are usually grateful families who had a loved one cared for by us. But in the case of what we're doing with these pets, providing them to dementia sufferers, people understand dementia and how devastating it is. And it's not a death sentence. I mean, people live for years with dementia in many cases. And so what I've discovered is we're getting people to contribute to our effort to provide these pets to dementia sufferers. who never thought about giving to an organization like us before. And so, and I'm going to be taking this PET initiative nationally through our 79 sister organizations in a couple months. So we're going to be doing national television, national, you know, social networking. And also, we're working with the Veterans Administration. So the Veterans Administration in our service area, Maryland, Virginia, and DC, they're telling all the families of veterans in our service area about this program so that they can apply for a free PET for a veteran in their family who has dementia. And we can take that national with the Veterans Administration as well.
So as you're developing this program, did you go seek the robotic PET, or did Hasbro already have that in production and you saw the opportunity there to apply it to something other than maybe what it had been planned for?
Right. Again, Hasbro spun it off back in 2016 as an independent entity, which is called Ageless Innovations. And the PET brand is called Joy for All. And as I like to say with these pets, no feeding, no pooping, no shedding, no kidding, just joy for all. And again, their focus is on older adults with dementia. And I got a hold of these folks because I had heard of them from friends of mine at AARP who had talked to them in the past. And so that's how I knew about this group. And, you know, as you saw, Mark, on the show, I interviewed the CEO of Ageless Innovations, Ted Fisher. And, you know, we have a great relationship. You know, we're going to be ordering hundreds and thousands of pets over the course of 2022. And it's miraculous what you see when a pet is given to a dementia patient. You know, they become calmer. They become less agitated in many, many cases, not a minority of the cases, but in a majority of the cases where a dementia patient has one of these pets, their medications can be reduced. It also allow them to keep them in their laps and next to them 24/7. So they're, you know, it also prevents loneliness. So it's wonderful to see. And, you know, dementia, of course, is primarily an old age affliction. And with us, you and me and our baby boomer compatriots growing older by the minute, dementia is increasing, right? So this is really something that can help. And we're not trying to fool anybody. But a lot of dementia patients really treat them as real pets. They often name them after pets they had in the distant past in their youth. And they just enjoy it so much and become much more socially amicable with those around them, their loved ones, their caregivers, and so forth.
And what's the lifespan of one of these robotic pets?
You know, as long as you can replace the batteries every 3 or 4 months. You can groom them. You can wash them with wipes. They're really quite remarkable. And they, you know, they have motion detection in their eyes and they respond to sound and touch. And the cats are programmed to act randomly, like the two cats that I own.
Yeah, I was going to say, you can't really program a cat to do anything that you want. We have cat. I mean, they can't be programmed.
No, and these cats are programmed to be random in terms of purring, meowing, moving their arms and legs, rolling on their back. These pets do everything, but they don't walk by themselves. But they do pretty much everything else that a live pet does. And the dogs bark and move their heads and paws. The dogs also have a heartbeat that you can feel. So I like to say that this is the polar opposite of Terminator artificial intelligence. This is artificial intelligence with massive amounts of humanity as part of it. And humanity is for dementia sufferers, as well as terminally ill children who often can't have a live pet with them. So, you know, it's wonderful to see.
Steve, we're going to take a very quick break here to acknowledge the underwriters that make programming here on Westfield Community Programming Channel 15 and 89.5 FM WSKB possible. We'll be back more with Steve Cohn from Capital Caring. Peter Coles is our chief engineer today. We're broadcasting from Studio 120 at Westfield Technical Academy. And if you missed a part of today's program or you want to share it with your friends, it's archived on YouTube at WSKB Community Radio. We'll be right back.
Support for Community Radio on WSKB is provided by Betts Plumbing and Heating Supply Company, an independent, family-owned wholesaler serving Westfield for over 50 years, specializing in plumbing, heating, and industrial piping supplies. On the web at BettsPlumbing.com or at 14 Coleman Avenue in Westfield.
Support for the community programming of WSKB is provided by the Dunkin' Donut Shops of Westfield and the Sardinia family. It's nice to know that even as the world changes, Dunkin' Coffee remains the same at 7 convenient locations throughout Westfield.
Join me, Tina Gorman, each week from 6 to 8 a.m. for Wake Up Wednesday, when my guests and I discuss health, wellness, and lifestyle reimagined.
Community Radio,
89.5 WSKB.
Live from Studio 120 at Westfield Technical Academy, this is WCPC Channel 15 and 89.5 FM WSKB Westfield.
Welcome back to On the Mark, everyone. I'm your host, Mark Auerbach. My guest this half hour is Steve Cohn, who's the communications, marketing, and philanthropy guru for Capital Caring in our nation's capital, and one of the people behind getting robotic pets into the hands of folks that have dementia or need companionship in some way, people young and old. Steve, how many of these robotic pets do you have around the house, or do they conflict with your cats?
The cats are very curious. I have a dog and I have a robotic dog and cat at home, and but I usually don't have them turned on because then they disturb my live cats. But if I did that, over time the live cats would be fine. So. You know, they're always suspicious that someone's going to steal their food, but obviously these pets don't. But it's a good question. Typically, live pets don't have any problem with the robotic being around. They're very curious about them initially, and then they kind of ignore them since they're not bothering them.
Yeah, because I can just imagine these would have to be these robotic pets would have to be pet-proof and child-proof. Are they durable? Are they the kind of thing that a toddler picks up and smashes against the wall? Are they done with, or can they?
A toddler would have to be pretty tough to damage them in any way. They're very sturdy. They're a hell of a lot sturdier than a live pet, you know, so a toddler could do damage to a live pet and vice versa. Obviously, in the case of robotics, they're not going to hurt anybody. And yes, they are extremely durable. You'd really have to have to be an adult to tear them apart. And, you know, that would take some doing too. They're very well built, and soft. Their fur is much like a live pet. You know, little kids couldn't tell the difference, and dementia patients can't tell the difference.
So they're indoor / outdoor, any room of the house kind of pets.
I wouldn't keep them out in the rain or the snow, but they can certainly go outdoors. They can go, I wouldn't, just like cats don't like rain either. They're very durable. They can go outside and stay inside. Typically with dementia patients, they keep them next to them, you know, 24/7. I've seen that personally. they're very easy to operate. You know, you flip one button under their tummy. There's three stations, either off, on, or mute. When they're on mute, they still do all their physical machinations, but, you know, they don't bark or meow. So
you said you're going to go national with this. If people want to learn more about it now, you said that there was information on your website. So how can people find out more about this program and where do they go to look?
Sure. So one place is they can go to capitalcaring.org/companionpets. I mean, if they're interested, Mark, in getting a link to our 30-minute show, they can email me at scone@capitalcaring.org. And C-O-N-E, as you know, scone@capitalcaring.org.
And will that video that you've done, will that be out and about? Is that going to be shown either on cable or YouTube? Or is there any way to access it at this point?
It's on YouTube. And it's called Living with Dementia, Robotic Pets Can Help, ! Living with Dementia, Robotic Pets Can Help. So people, yes, they can go to YouTube and find it. While it is a version for Capital Caring Health, we are creating a new version that is a national one. That won't be done for another month or so. But, you know, the current program, as you know, really covers the landscape on these pets. I interview a daughter who's caring for her mother with dementia, who has two robotic dogs. I talk to the CEO. I talk to one of our head of clinical services, Dr. Leanne West, about how clinicians are so thrilled with what they see with these pets in the hands of patients. And I talk to a local business head of our gas utility company who are supporting our, what I call Pets for Veterans program, to get these pets in the hands of veterans with dementia.
And people can go to your website and just directly order them, have them shipped to wherever they like.
Yes, and unlike ordering them from Amazon, I've got nothing against Amazon, of course, but unlike ordering them on Amazon, if you buy them from us, it's tax deductible. So, and they're $150 a piece. Two different versions of dogs. One looks like a golden retriever. One looks like a Brittany Spaniel, if people know what that is. And the cats come in three colors, tabby, silver, and black and white. There's another creature that will be coming out in a couple months, but I'm not allowed to talk about it yet.
Okay, so the people have to go back to capitalcaring.org on a regular basis to see what's coming down the road, so to speak.
Well, capitalcaring.org/companionpets. They don't have to go to our normal website. They can just go right through that landing page to see what we're up to.
So you must have other irons in the fire besides this, but is this one of the more satisfying projects you've gotten to work on in the last few years?
You know, it is, because it's something that I just thought would be really beneficial to so many people. And, you know, my colleagues and I at Capital Caring Health are taking the lead nationally on this effort. And so that gives me a lot of satisfaction about how we're able to expand care for dementia patients way beyond Washington, D.C. And, you know, there are about 8 million dementia sufferers in the United States. 1.5 million of them are veterans. So many of them could benefit from having one of these, or two of them. And it's very satisfying to, do this effort. Another effort, which we also started here, is what we call advanced cardiac care. So tens of thousands of people with heart failure die alone in a hospital every year, and it's totally unnecessary, because groups like us and Care Dimensions up your way provide in-home care for heart failure patients. So They can be treated at home. They never have to be rushed to the hospital. You don't have to call 911. You don't have to eventually die alone in an ICU. You can stay in your home or your residence. If you have heart failure, and heart disease is the biggest killer of adults in America by far. And so that's another major effort that we started with 29 other not-for-profit hospice groups back in 2020.
So if people want to learn more about Capital Care and all that, give me the website one more time.
Sure. The general website is very simple, capitalcaring.org.
Steve Cohn, we're out of time, but I want to thank you for being with us this morning, and all best of luck with the robotic pet program. I hope that people that are listening that want one of these for a relative or a friend that is dealing with or living with dementia, or a child who's dealing with cancer and stuff, will reach out and see what this program offers. Thanks for being here, Steve.
Thanks for having me, Mark. Great to see you, too.
Good to see you, too. And that wraps up another edition of On the Mark. We leave you today with music by Stephen Sondheim from his film Reds. We'll be back next week with another edition of On the Mark.
Until whenever then, we're free.